Today's presentation will discuss a breakthrough in the analysis of pesticide residues in food as it relates to catcher sample preparation and GCMSMS analysis. We'll look at catcher's miniaturization, 75% less sample injected by the GCMSMS, LOQs less than or equal to 10 nanograms per gram reaching at or below established MRLs. You will discover the following information. What are the advantages and new options available with reduced sample amount using the catcher's approach? How do I maintain the same sample solvent salt ratio used in the catcher's approach? What are the advantages to injecting only 25% of the expected sample volume into the 70-10 triple quadrupole GCMS? An evaluation of the data reaching at or below MRLs. The EPA, EU, and Japan have established pesticide MRLs, which are maximum residue limits. These limits are considered safe limits, which defines the maximum expected levels of pesticides in food commodities. Having MRLs are very important because they serve to prevent illegal or excessive use of pesticides, and therefore protect the health of consumers and the environment where pesticides can end up and concentrate in rivers, streams, and soil. In 2003, the USDA introduced a method that allowed for multi-residue analysis of pesticides in a fraction of the time compared to existing methods. The method is known as catchers. Catchers stands for quick, easy, cheap, effective, rugged, and safe. When combined with sensitive and selective detectors like TANMMS, allows for multi-residue analysis of pesticides with minimal sample cleanup. The catchers method is based on either a 10 or a 15 gram sample, which has been determined to exemplify a representative sampling. The steps for the catches method are the following. Weigh homogenized sample into a disposable polypropylene centrifuge tube. Add two ceramic homogenizers, which are weighted ceramic grinding agents that will help facilitate the extraction partitioning in the first step of catchers. Add spiked analytes if needed and internal standard. Add acetonitrile and Vortex for a minute. Add the catcher salts from the salt packets and shake vigorously for at least 1 minute, then centrifuge at 5,000 RPM for 5 minutes. The sample, after centrifugation, will form three layers, shown here, where the top layer is the acetonitrile layer of interest that will be transferred to the second step of catchers, the dispersive SPE. So take an aliquot of the top acetonitrile layer, transfer it to the dispersive SPE tube. This tube contains magnesium sulfate and some type of solid phase extraction sorbent. For instance, PSA, primary secondary amine, C18, or graphitized carbon black, GCB. Vortex the tube for a minute and then centrifuge. The liquid layer is ready for analysis. The extract is amenable for both LC and GCMSMS analysis. Please remember that catchers is not an exhaustive sample cleanup method, so there will be some matrix in the extract, hence the need for using TANMMS to selectively pull out compounds of interest with a matrix background. So the bottom line here, though, is if you can weigh, pipette and shake, and you have a centrifuge, you can do catchers. As with all scientific methods of analysis, we are always striving to improve or optimize the method. So, what if we miniaturize the analytical approach? Let's first look at catcher sample preparation method. What might miniaturizing it offer researchers? Well, it's easier to handle. Weighing less samples, so therefore centrifuge tubes can be smaller. You could process more samples at once. Less storage required, similar to our ease of use with handling smaller samples. Reduction in process time, not necessarily applicable, since a sample still requires the same number of steps. reduced salt and sorbent cost because we're processing less sample per extraction, reduced costs of labeled compounds, and in fact, for troublesome compounds, adding additional labeled compounds wouldn't be cost prohibited. For instance, Captan D6 and Folpet D4. Reduction in solvent cost and waste based on less sample, and so therefore less solvents are required. Keeping the same dispersive SPE kits that are already in existence. One of the key features of this scaled-down approach is that we maintain the same sample to salt to solvent ratio, and therefore we would expect to achieve similar results as with the validated Ketcher's method. Let's see if that's true. Along those same lines, what if we have the ability to reduce the injected sample volume? This is now a viable option with our new 7010 triple quadrupole GCMS. The 7010 triple quadrupole GCMS improvement is not based on software changes, but is in fact a new ultra-efficient ionization source, hence a new hardware design. The ultra-efficient ionization source is capable of achieving lower levels of detection and response, where dilution of the sample prior to injection might actually be necessary. In the case of the multi-residue pesticide extraction, we were able to inject only 25% of the standard 2 microliter injection, or 0.5 microliter injection volume. Keep in mind that Ketcher's is not an exhaustive sample cleanup, so if you inject less sample, then you are introducing less matrix to the GCMS/MS system, which translates to less matrix buildup on the liner and columns, resulting in prolonged uptime and increased chromatographic ruggedness, overall sustained performance. So let's take a brief look at how we evaluated the miniaturization of the Ketcher's method. For the first step, extraction partitioning, all the steps are maintained. Only the amounts have been proportionately reduced. So, for a 2 gram homogenized sample, we add two ceramic homogenizers, then 2 mL of acetonitrile, Vortex, 1 gram of the AOAC salts, shake and centrifuge. Transfer 1 mL of the extract to a 2 mL dispersive SPE tube, Vortex and centrifuge. The choice in the dispersive SPE is going to be dependent on the type of sample matrix. The sample is now ready either for GC or LC-MS/MS analysis. As mentioned earlier, Ketcher's sample preparation methods allows for the extraction of compounds from complex matrices. However, it does not exhaustively remove all the contaminants from the analytical system. Hence, backflushing the GC columns ensures that the high-boiling compounds in the matrix are not passed through the column, reduces column bleed, eliminates ghost peaks, and minimizes contamination of the mass spectrometer. This technique, coupled with the ultra-efficient ionization source in the 7010 triple quadrupole GCMS, allows for smaller injection volumes while still achieving low sensitivity of target analytes. The slide shows two GC inlet liners that have different sample volumes injected over the course of a sequence. The lower left liner in A has a greater amount of sample injected, 2.0 microliters over 65 injections, and clearly contains increased deposits, which shortens the usable lifetime of the lighter and adds additional maintenance cost. The right liner, B, has reduced sample volume injected, 0.5 microliters, but over 200+ injections. As you can see, it's almost free of visible deposits, shown clearly within the magnified view, which prolongs performance and decreased maintenance cost. This study used three matrices, Apple, Captan, carrot, and broccoli to assess the miniaturization catcher's method for routine multi-residue pesticide analysis. 126 commonly monitored pesticides by GCMSMS were chosen for the study. The figure shows a representative overlay of the chromatograms for a fortified broccoli matrix with 126 pesticides at 10 nanograms per gram. Calibration standards for a mixture of 126 pesticides and groups of pesticide isomers were prepared by spiking the extracted blank matrix at 1, 5, 10, 20, 50, and 100 nanograms per gram. The figure indicates the precision of the method. Percent RSD at N equals 6 were determined based on calculated amount. Calibration sets yielded correlation coefficient values that were greater than 0.99 for 95% of the 126 pesticides spiked in all matrices evaluated, apple, carrot, and broccoli. If I call out the amount of resmethrin 1 and 2 pesticides at 5 nanograms per gram standard injected in a 0.5 microliter injection volume, this is 2.5 picograms on column, as opposed to 10 picograms when using a 2 microliter injection. This is a 75% reduction in sample amount on column. Even with this reduction in injected sample, optimal chromatography for some of the most challenging pesticides was maintained at half the default MRL, or 5 nanograms per gram, or even below. The recovery was evaluated by spiking the pesticide standards in apple, carrot, and broccoli at levels of 5, 10, and 50 nanograms per gram. These QC samples were quantitated against the matrix spike calibration curve. The analysis was performed in replicates of 3 at each level. The distribution of recovery for the pre-spike matrices are shown in the slide. The percentage of pesticides that fell within the acceptable mean recovery range of 70 to 120% in apple averaged 95%. Acceptable recoveries in carrot averaged 95%, and for broccoli averaged 96%. There were a handful of pesticides in carrot and broccoli that were slightly outside of the 70 to 120% range, but they were accepted based on the RSDs being substantially lower than 20%. And this is called out in the Sanko guidelines. Calibration standards for the mixture of 126 individual pesticides and groups of pesticide isomers were prepared spiking the extraction blank matrix at 1 to 100 nanograms per gram. The figure in this slide shows the distribution of percent RSD for the 126 pesticides in apple, carrot, and broccoli at 1 and 5 nanograms per gram using a 0.5 microliter injection volume. The limit of quantitation that were observed during this study were estimated based on the following criteria: percent RSD less than or equal to 20%, and signal to noise greater than 10 for calculated amounts. There are 35 pesticides that are commonly monitored in the 3 matrices listed in the table. The table is set up such that the published MRLs from the EPA and the EU are listed to the left of the estimated LOQs determined from this study. Moving from left to right, we show the information for apple, carrot, and broccoli. Captan and Fulpet are base sensitive and often present issues in terms of recovery from matrix and precision during analysis. Although not used in this study, the evaluation of Captan D6 and Fulpet D4 as internal standards is recommended to control recovery and assure reliable results, especially for longer batches in which the number of injections exceeds 40. Here, without the use of the specified internal standards and well over 40 injections, Captan yielded estimated LOQs of 10 nanograms per gram for apple, which is below the MRL, but greater than 50 nanograms per gram, which is above the MRL for carrot and broccoli. Full PET, on the other hand, yielded estimated LOQs greater than 50 nanograms per gram for all three matrices, which is above the established MRLs. The ability to use a smaller sample size, the 2 grams, in the Ketcher's sample preparation extraction equates to less volume of labeled analytes spiked into the samples and therefore substantial reduction in cost per sample. Additional labeled compounds such as Captan D6 and Folpet D4 could be easily included without significant cost increases per sample, improving recovery and reliability. With a smaller sample size, the amount of spiked Captan D6 and Folpet D4 would cost 4 cents per sample, whereas with a 10 to 15 gram sample size, it would be on the order of 40 cents per sample. This is a tenfold cost savings. So, what's our take-home message? Well, I hope we've proven that the miniaturization of the Ketcher's extraction method can substantially decrease sample preparation cost by 80% with less solvent, solvent waste, salts, and reduction in the amount of internal standards required. Maintaining the same ratio of sample to solvent to salt, therefore yielding a 1 gram per mil extract as used in the validated Ketcher's method, did produce excellent results from this preliminary study, as expected. Applicability for the monitoring agencies will still need to be determined. In other words, is a 2 gram sample representative of a commodity to be tested? The ultra-efficient ionization source is expected to reduce sample costs by allowing for an increased number of samples to be injected before GC liner replacement is required. By using the existing analytical method and employing the ultra-efficient ionization source, which allows for only 25% of the previously required injected sample volume, together with the miniaturization of Ketcher's, 95% of the pesticide residues analyzed in apple, carrot, and broccoli were able to be quantified in the study at or below the default threshold of 10 nanograms per gram. And that concludes our study. Thank you very much.